Welcome to the fifth edition of the Hirist Tech Talk, guys. My name is Abhor. I'm a part of the marketing function at Hirist.com, and I'm extremely delighted to have you all join us today, right on time at 4 p.m., guys. Some of you guys were here for our last few webinars. Some of you guys are coming here for the first time. If you'd like to check out what you've missed in the earlier episodes, I'll share the YouTube links in the chat box. So guys, today we have the pleasure of conducting the fifth edition of this series in collaboration with the tech leadership at VMware. Balaji, who's the Senior Director IT at VMware, and Shaji, who's the Domain Architect at VMware, will be leading this session today. So guys, Balaji is an accomplished IT leader with experience in technology-enabled business outcomes delivery at companies like VMware, Accenture, Tech Mahindra, and has successfully led business and digital transformation across various business domains. Whereas Shaji is an enterprise domain architect and a technologist with more than 20 years of industry experience in driving digital transformation, guys. Also, he's a learner and follower of technology evolution, much like all of you who've joined us today. So today they'll share their thoughts on the topic, guys, on digital transformation, 5 hours of app modernization. And before we start with this topic, guys, I request you all to post all the questions in the Q&A box you see on the right-hand side. We've also received some of the questions from you guys earlier over email, and we'll also be taking those up, you know. Balaji and Shaji will be taking as many questions as possible, guys, obviously towards the end of the webinar. And without any further ado, guys, I think we'll get right to the topic of discussion at hand. So over to you guys.
Thanks, Vibhor. How are you? Thanks. Good afternoon, folks, and thanks for joining, taking time on a Friday afternoon. It's me, Balaji, I take care of enterprise architecture at VMware, and my colleague Shaji. Shaji, you want to quickly introduce yourself?
Yeah, thanks, Balaji. Thanks, Vibhor. Thanks for having me. Excited to be here. So I have been an enterprise domain architect in VMware for the last 12 years right now. And before that, I was in consulting and have been doing digital transformation across the world.
Thanks, Shaji. We'll get started. Hope you're able to see the slide deck in the display mode.
Yeah, Balaji, I think we all can see that, yeah.
Thank you, appreciate it. Thanks again for joining. Just start with us. When we started this pandemic sometime in February, right? That was a typical feel-good factor. It's work from home situation. So we thought, okay, I'm going to talk about myself now. So I thought, okay, there's a lot of time at hand. What can I do, right? I can start some new hobbies. So what do? I wanted to learn some music instruments. And the typical thing is go start, what do you do typically, right? You go start browsing Amazon and everywhere and start getting those tools, right? Basically in this case, music instrument. Basically what we end up doing is immediate gratification. We just go try one after another and see whether this fits the bill or that fits the bill, whether I can learn this or not, right? It's not only true in case of hobbies, but it's also true in case of anything, even in this world, when we call digital transformation or apps modernization or DevOps. The tendency is the tools would solve our problems, but does it really solve our problems? Does it really make sense to start buying tools first before we have a plan in hand? Today's session, me and Shaji are going to talk about what is driving these app modernizations. What are the options on the table and how we go about, especially in an enterprise world, right? What are the options on the table and how we are going to go about? That's going to be the core focus of today's session. Before I get started, feel free to type in the chat box, what is it when it comes to DevOps to you, right? What is DevOps to you? Sorry, I'm not able to see the chat box. Give me a minute. Shaji, if you are able to see if there are any comments on the chat box, if you can read out for us.
Not Balaji.
Okay. So feel free to type in the chat box your comments or your what do you think about DevOps. But typically what happens is DevOps, when we talk about DevOps, right? People end up thinking these are the tools and tool sets of DevOps that comes to the perspective. Probably reduction of time, faster to market and so on, right? So these are the thought process. But if to be consistent in terms of what exactly is the DevOps concept is basically a culture As like any other self-respecting adult, I wanted to be consistent. So I went and Googled, and first thing that you look upon is what the wiki definition is. And probably I found it more appropriate. If you look at the DevOps definition, right, there are three fundamental essence of it, right? One is in terms of shortening the system development lifecycle. Second is providing a continuous delivery. And third is high quality software, right? So the three vectors on which you will be measured, primarily bringing the dev and ops together as a culture to deliver it, everything is treated as an engineering problem, right? So what is it trying to solve? It's primarily trying to solve what we call last mile in the terminology, right? What is the last mile? Basically, the last mile is once the code is checked in, the time it takes to be integrated, tested, deployed, right? And released into production, that's primarily the last mile. The objective of a DevOps construct is ability to reduce or eliminate the last mile. That is what it is, right? And that's the reason why the second part of the component, which is the last mile, where majority of the ops component is involved, is trying to treat everything as a code, right? So that's a concept of a DevOps that we are going to talk about. And let's look at how industry is measuring the DevOps metrics, right? The first fundamental metrics is how frequently we are deploying the code right? With the highly high performing team, that's what it is called in terms of a mature DevOps practices, it has enabled the teams to get to 208 times more in terms of frequency of deployment, right? In terms of the code. The second component is, or rather I will go back to that, right? The classic question that is asked is how long it takes for a blank line of code that is checked in to get to production. Basically, your code is a value to production or value to the market, and a blank line of code that is checked, how long it takes to production, right? So it is 208 times probably more deployment is happening. It is 106 times faster in terms of commit to deploy. That is what it means is basically the last mile, right? When you code commit, after that integrate, test, deploy, release, right? So all the things put together is 106 times faster when it comes to a high performing team. So the concept of another important aspect of a DevOps culture is ability to fail fast, recover fast, right? And it is measured in terms of the time to recover. And primarily what the industry metric says is about 2,600 odd times faster in terms of ability to recover, because it is a very contained code base that we are talking about, right? And obviously the change failure rate, that is when you deploy, the failure of the change, that is the change that goes to production, is 7 times lower than what it was earlier, right? So these are the key metrics on which the DevOps constructs are measured when it comes to industry. But let's go back to our topic, right? What is the two fundamental vectors on which I would like to measure the speed at which I can take the code, in this case, value to market, right? There are two components, faster to production and high code quality. How is it possible to have these two? The two drive to make it happen, there are two fundamental aspects that we need to consider. They are, it is a smaller controlled purpose-built code, which means I have a control on the complete code base. I know when I touch one part of the code, what impact is it has on the other part of the code. And it is being delivered by a small domain-based delivery teams. Basically, the concept of the two pizza size teams that AWS talks about is all coming from this concept that it is, I can contain the code, I can contain the team which is delivering this code base, right? That is what it is going to make you faster to production and make sure that the quality of the code is high and it is very contained as well as you are sure about it, right? So these are the two driving aspects in terms of apps modernization. This is anchored on these two fundamental aspects, how I can take value to the market faster and how do I deploy the code with high quality, right? And the second concept I'd like to introduce, what is technical debt according to you? I'll wait for a couple of seconds before I move on.
So I think, Balaji, there's a Q&A box on the right-hand side. Candidates are answering in the Q&A box. I think you can see it on the right-hand side.
Yeah, sure. Because in the presentation mode, for some reasons, I'm not able to see that tool. But Shaji, if you can look at it, what are they? according to them.
Yeah, sorry, right? I was on mute. Yeah, I think there are some answers came in. So DevOps is basically developer plus operation and experience.
Yeah, let's focus on this question. What is the technical debt, tech debt, according to you? We'll wait for a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Any comments, Shaji, from the
team? Implied cost of additional rework.
Okay, great.
So it can be code review comments that need to be done.
Okay, fine. That's right. Okay.
Code smells and defects.
Code smells and defects. Okay. That gives a dipstick in terms of how the thought process is. Basically, the tendency in our culture, basically how it is, when I say it's culture, it's globally as well. The debt is treated as something bad. Okay. And there is an association of, okay, it is something wrong or bad associated with it, right? But if you look at, and even probably coming from the culture of the Merchant of Venice, hope you guys have read in some point of time, the Shakespeare, and what do you think about it? When you say pound of flesh, the pound of flesh is always associated with the Sherlock, who is the villain in this, is sort of a villain in this tale, right? Primarily, the association of debt, something to do with bad, is probably the cultural aspect of it. But is it really debt bad? The roof under which I'm staying is basically because I took a home loan, right? So not all debts are bad. Debts are good as long as it is contained. So the fundamental shift in the paradigm is, we need to start thinking all codes are technical debts. Even if it is a perfect code, it is a technical debt. Okay, it's not only the defects, but the whole code base is a technical debt. Okay, and if you keep that mindset, over a period of time, the code base is going to become old over a period of time, right? That's what we call it legacy. It doesn't meet your current needs, the modern way of doing things. And obviously the interest that we pay to maintain that in terms of the speed, agility, time to market, and the confidence of the code base is going to go over a period of time low. So when you start doing the thinking this way, only thing is what you'll start doing is evaluating. Is it better to continue with the minimum interest rate for a home loan and invest that money somewhere else? Or should I close the home loan because the interest is ballooning? Okay, so that's a fundamental concept. Start thinking every code base is a technical debt and how do you deal with it? So basically, what we are trying to get to a point is not all have the same way of solving the problem. One size doesn't fit all. But there is a myth saying that microservices will solve everything. Not necessarily. Okay. There are various alternates available. You need to weigh in between the debt versus what is the interest that you're going to pay. What is it going to be the trade-off? And accordingly make those decisions. That's the context that we are going to talk about in subsequently. Shaji, the question for you, what are potentially the interest that is going to be ballooning when it comes to a code base, which is going to become legacy or a monolith in nature, right? Because we do deal with that. So what do you think these are the interests that we end up paying and what are the alternates and options available to get out of it?
Thanks, Balaji. That's an interesting question, right? And as you said, right, the technical debt is neither good nor bad, right? The reason is that from a developer perspective or a development team perspective, right, it is always a ship or sink mode, right? Because you get an opportunity that, hey, we need to ship this product faster or you need to develop this application faster. So in that speed, what do you do is you build an application without much thought and much design in it. And then you start building on adding feature on top of it, adding one by one. Over a period of time, you see that a sea of features within that application, and there is no proper code management, and you lose control over the code, no documentation. And then sometimes even the technology get obsolete and you do not get resources to work on it. So it becomes like a ball of mud. And in that, when it becomes ball of mud, what happens is that you lose that if a new feature need to be added, you have to say to the business that, hey, I cannot do that, because if I have to roll out this particular feature, I need much more time. The release, the agility of release is not available right now, because it takes longer testing cycle, because the code base is complex. So the deployment becomes slower, and then it becomes less scalable, because you cannot scale a particular feature specifically from the business perspective. So the agility actually decreases. And then finally, you are basically going to sink in that ship. So it becomes less and less available. The availability becomes very less and less. So this is what, in my experience, I have faced, Balaji. So whether I started as a developer, and then at that time, we didn't have much tools available, software from the languages, if you look at three databases, and those are like vendor-specific databases, and then limited programming languages. So you build application that was specifically for a desktop, when the industry maturity happens and you have more and more technology comes into picture, you venture into new areas like SOA and all these, the service-oriented architecture model, but you still keep building that kind of a monolithic application. So now the question is that how do we actually, so those are the technical debts that you talk about, right? Because that was the need of the hour. Neither it is bad nor it is good, right? It is an interest that we pay. So if you can go to the next slide, Balaji. Yeah.
How do you characterize in this case, right? Now things have changed, and how do you characterize a modern application, right? What is a modern application in the current world?
Sure. So we all talk about what is a modern application, right? Modern application is something which is very reactive. When you say reactive, what does that mean? Reactive means it has to be responsive, right? The system should respond to any kind of eventuality, and it gives a consistent response time in any situation, right? So whether you have, say for example, you have an application which you have rolled out to the customer, and suddenly, say for example, you see a sudden surge of customers coming in. You saw in pandemic, right, the number of payments, the digital payments got increased. And we saw the cases where some of the prominent banks in India, they had availability problem. And so these are the things that you look at, right? Because your application needs to be resilient and reactive to the needs. And then as part of the process, you have to release this application, the features, much in a much faster way. So you think about a continuous delivery model. And then all of these things generate a huge amount of data. And how do you actually consume that data? So you provide insight. So you provide analytics to this application so that they can actually provide the feedback and insight to the business. And then wherever it is needed, right, you need to have a proper automation and provide that capability and have a matured process in place. And these are the characteristic of the modern applications.
I would like to add one more point when it comes to continuous delivery, right? You would be noting it down, people coming from this background, we are not calling it continuous deployment, we are calling it continuous delivery, okay? The difference being, you need to design the application to be independently operatable, independently deployable unit. That is starting from the feature definition onwards. So only when the feature is contained enough at the time of definition of your what, then it takes into an ability to be continuously deployed. The typical tendency is the code can be continuously deployed, but can the feature can be continuously delivered is something that we need to be looking at. So that's the difference in which that we are looking at, rather than just thinking it is a continuous pipeline of delivery only. Yep. If that makes sense. Chaji, again, moving to the next topic, right? How do you see, like any enterprise, how do they go into this journey, starting from stating the problem to solving the problem, right? Can you talk us through through both the problem space and the solution space.
Sure. See, if you look at, if it is a small scale, an IT actually could start this journey, right? But if a modernization required in a large scale, IT cannot actually do it alone because you need to bring all the stakeholders together. And from an organization perspective, you need to have that vision and clarity in that modernization plan. And the clarity means you have to tell every stakeholder that where we are right now and where are we going to, right? And that align and then bring that alignment across the business stakeholders, the culture and all the people involved, and change that culture and the technology perspective. That alignment is required. That is the first starting point, which we would say that where the modernization would start. And then come to the planning.
I'll stop you on this, right? In probably in a VMware case, there's a little difference in that, right? We started our journey of breaking the monolith into microservices even before we get the alignment with the business, because we started delivering the value, they saw the value, and then obviously the alignment happened. So right. In that case, there are situations with the technology-driven change that is potential. So in that case, the question is, how do you measure your risk and how do you touch what type of application that you would touch?
Sure, that's a good question, Balaji. So specifically, if you look at, right, seeing is always believing, right? So unless the stakeholders, whoever, whether it is a customer-facing application or whether it is your colleague experience, whatever you see is basically what they are going to believe. So in such cases, what you need to look at is that what are those applications where you think that there are problem areas and identify. For example, right, you talked about from the VMware perspective, right? So one of the applications that we had, we were managing, we found that the large customers were actually facing a lot of issues when especially filing a support request, right? And it takes longer time for them to file a support request because they have a huge data. So we solved that particular issue, and then customers were happy, and you see suddenly the CSAT score went up. And that is one of the triggering points. And then you suddenly pick up another one, which is an employee facing, where an employee has experience, we can say it is a bad experience in dealing with some of the these applications. You can actually provide a way that, say, for example, if you look at, right, if an employee has to, or a manager has to approve so many various types of approvals, like whether it is a procurement related or whether it is a leave application or a concur expenses. If you provide an opportunity in such a way that, okay, you have a mobile application or you have one place that they can see that all the alerts with respect to these notifications are coming and then where they can approve it, that is a productivity that you are giving. So always look at those areas where you can find that where customers or your employees can get the real benefit.
Yeah, thanks, Shaji. So that's what I want to drive that point, right? There are two ways of approaching it, obviously, vision and manage vision coming from the top down. But if there is something that the respective IT organization also wants to take control, identify a high value transaction, which is impactful, start addressing that problem, prove the concept so that the alignment becomes easy. Identify the pilots and start your journey as well. So it's both is possible, but obviously the success will always determine coming from the vision of the organization to move towards, right? Shaji, let's move.
So that vision, so the organization, so if it is a large scale modernization, then the organization has to set that vision and there should be an alignment across all the portfolios and all the business stakeholders, right? Unless that, unless you have that, it becomes a challenging for them. And then you identify in the plan and execute phase, what you do is that you identify your digital assets and then identify which portfolios that you are going to touch upon and then expand those areas and then identify that what is the road to modernization, because you will never go as a big bang, right? You will not actually try to rock your boat. you will go in a step-by-step fashion, and that is more safest way to go to the modernization, start the modernization journey. And when you land and expand, so this is where you will actually start seeing the actual benefits of the modernization, right? You start, whether you start slowly or whether you start in a big bang, identify that, okay, you have seen that these are the benefits. And then you start you consolidate the all these experiences and start building a center of excellence, whether the center of excellence could be in a cloud area, or it could be in an analytics area, where you can feed back this information or give this insight back to the business and then take the next journey. And then in the maturity part, right? So the maturity does not come on the first day itself, right? So it is a continuous process. You take the feedback and collect those metrics and identify that what are the areas that you need to bring, or do you need to go back and see that any change need to be done in your next planning and execution mode, and build a governance model. When I say governance model, don't think that it become a bureaucratic model, right? And you stop your, because governance model always think that it is a governance and they stop the innovation. So in this scenario, you have to look at that the innovation doesn't stop. So you have a proper governance model, especially when you are actually moving on to the cloud.
Yeah, thanks, Shaji. So this apps modernization and cloud journey are like twin sisters, right? They go hand in hand. But obviously, when we go to cloud, there are options available on the table. Not that everything need to be cloud native, not everything need to be microservices, right? So can you walk us through what are the options when it comes to cloud?
Sure. So everybody talks about the cloud, right? Nowadays, I don't see that anyone who would not talk about cloud. So the cloud applications, when you talk about cloud native applications, right, there is a difference. So it goes in a step-by-step manner. There are, because if you look at companies like Netflix or Amazon, the journey has never been like, okay, they were on the first day itself, the cloud native, right? It is always a step-by-step process. The first step anybody would take is either a cloud ready or in a cloud friendly manner. In a cloud ready model, you will not get more of the benefits of the cloud, because you are just deploying an application in a much broader sense. You say that, okay, you're creating a microservice and then you are actually deploying that onto a cloud infrastructure. But in that state, that is where you start your journey. And then you basically evolve, and then you expand your microservice area where you apply all your 12-factor practices, and then scalability. And then that is where you can say that, hey, we are in a cloud-friendly state, right? Because your applications are at least highly available. And then you go to the next step, in a more matured state, which is where the deployments, your pipelines are automated and you have a complete observability, end-to-end observability of your applications. And you can see that, okay, when a failure happens, you have the resiliency. And here I would talk about that availability, right? There are two types of availability. One is basically high availability, and we call the second type is called a continuous availability. So there is a difference between these two, right? High availability is when you actually fail something and then move over to the next one, right? In a continuous availability perspective, you look at that, you see that the application is fault tolerant, and you proactively identify that, okay, the application is going to fail over before even failing. So you know the story of this tree falling in the forest, right? So the question was, and a fourth grader asked the teacher, when a tree falls in a forest, and if nobody is around to hear the sound, does it make a sound? So the, if the application failover happens in a continuous availability model, you never really notice that, or the customer or from an employee perspective, you never know that, okay, the application has failed, now it is failing over. Because in a high availability, there is a failover time, few seconds of blip or a few minutes of blip from one system to another system. That is a high availability system. You flip from one system to another. But in a proactive, in a continuous failover mode, you do not notice that, because the system is very proactive and identifies that. It is very preemptive in nature that a system is not behaving properly. And because of the data that you collected, right, and the abnormality of the anomalies that you find, you identify that, or the system is going to fail. So you switch to, even before the fault happens, you switch to other. So that's why you'll not hear the sound. So that is the story of the tree falling in a forest. And then the more matured state is where the cloud native application, which is elastic scaling, right? Where most of the application may not need this, because we know that we do not have that kind of a business that Netflix or Amazon is doing or Flipkart is doing, right? And if the best way to gauge this is that, can we actually do this without a human intervention, right? Can that scaling can happen automatically? So that is where the elastic scaling happens. If suddenly there is a surge, you never know. Nobody expected that COVID situation, right? And suddenly people are actually making digital payments and all the online grocery shopping, everything becomes online, right? So how do you how does your application behave in such a scenario? So you need to have an auto scaling mechanism. And then we talked about the reactive application, where we have the consistent response time, right? In any situation, you have a consistent response time. Have you ever seen that, okay, when you go to Google or when you go to Amazon, you see a difference that, okay, it is taking longer time? I never experienced that. When you go to Google says that, okay, it could be an issue with the network, but the Google response has always been within milliseconds, right? And then we talk about the self-healing mechanism, right? Self-healing is the architecture has to be, so when you are creating that kind of an application, right? You are building an application which is very reactive to a decomposable infrastructure. So you never know that when this particular server is going to fail, or when this particular VM is going to be unavailable. So if the VM is unavailable, how the self-healing can happen? It spins up another VM, or it spins up another container. So that's a self-healing property of the cloud native. And most importantly, no human touch point. Everything that you deliver as a code, even the infrastructure change, is going to be just a code push. So that way you will always maintain the audit part, that hey, who has done this, and how this change has occurred. Everything is through the code. So that is the final state of cloud native.
Thanks, Shaji. So which means in one sense, right, to get to full automation and seamless experience is going to be more expensive than the minimum refactoring, right? So which means going back to our original introduction, the technical debt and what is the value that we want to drive will determine to what extent we want to go. So going back to the same fundamental things, microservices may not be the only solution. There are options on the table. And keeping this cloud options, what are the ways that you can, the 5 R's, right? Going to our core of the topics, what are the 5 R's that we have when it comes to applications, and how we make decisions, Shaji, in an enterprise world, even being an architect, right? You're seeing 400 plus applications and 200 plus SaaS applications, right? How do you make those decisions?
Sure, that's an interesting question, Balaji. So this is Gartner's 5R framework, right? And I think this came very early when the cloud adoption happened. I think it was in 2010 or 2011. Yeah. And over a period of time, you see that there is a lot of cloud adoption happened, and every organization has actually adopted in some form of other of this particular framework. So, but the fundamental concept of this 5R framework is basically that how do you identify this application, right? And what is the way that to go to the cloud? So the first and fundamental thing is that the rehosting, right? The rehosting happens in multiple ways. One is basically just a lift and shift. You have an application which is running in a virtualized environment. Today, I think most of the applications run in a virtualized environment. So it is easy for you to lift and shift that on-prem model onto a cloud host. So when I say on-prem model, right, there are two fundamental things, Balaji, here, right? So people think that the private cloud is nothing but an on-prem model. But that is not exactly true, right? So not every enterprise have that kind of a scalability and resiliency, right? If you are running an application in a single server where your database is running on a single server and your application server is on on that, and UI, everything is running on a single server, we cannot say that that's the private cloud. So there is a cloud characteristic. There are five or six cloud characteristics. So the scalability, resiliency, and all these come in that cloud characteristic. So if you're running in a virtualized environment, most probably you will have some of these characteristics. So in that case, what you would like to do is that, how do I reduce my dependency on this infrastructure, right? If you have an application which is just running as a KTLO application, right? You don't want to do add many features to it. Just want to keep the lights on. In such a case, you can actually do a lift and shift onto the cloud infrastructure, which is a rehosting of that application, right? And refactoring needs a little bit of the modification here and there, right? Especially the configuration changes in the architecture. Even in rehosting also, you need to have the configuration changes. And here, your application need to be refactored in such a way that works in that kind of an environment, in a cloud environment. So that is a refactoring. So there is a slight code change required in that.
Refactoring, the extreme refactoring is equal to conversion to monolith to microservices. Is it a right statement to make here?
So extreme refactoring would fall into the re-architecture and the rebuilding of this part. But if you say that, okay, organization doesn't have that much, doesn't want to invest that much money into this, but they wanted to make this available for in a much bigger environment, make it a little bit more availability for this particular application. In such cases, you would actually would go for a refactoring, where there is a minimal code change and minimal configuration required. So when you go to re-architecting that application, right? You don't want to actually completely change this application. So because that is one of your critical applications, but you wanted to do underlying infrastructure change, which probably is not running in a well-mannered way. So you wanted to take the advantage of the cloud, but at the same time, you need to do a moderate change in the way that the code has been written. If it has already been written in a cloud, in a microservice way, probably you have to apply your 12 factor, all the 12 factors within that code, and then architecture part at the application level, and then replace the underlying architecture. So that is the re-architect part. When you come to the rebuilding, right, you see that, okay, I have a large, big ball of mud. I do not know what exactly the functionality or the features the customers are using, right? And even business do not know that what exactly the features are using. And then they would come and say that, okay, at least I can say that these are the features that we want. So you start building completely a cloud native application with new architecture, completely on a blank slate. So that is the rebuilding. And replacing is mostly come into people would say replace is kind of a repurchase, right? If you have already an application which is a commercially off-the-shelf application, and you wanted to replace that because the vendor doesn't support that. So especially if you look at in the COVID time, right, nobody goes to the office. But you, if you have an application which forces you to go to office to operate, then it becomes a challenge, right? So you would ask the vendor that, hey, what is an alternative? Can I actually, do you have the cloud version of this application that we can use? So most probably people use, you remember those office email before Office 365. If you have an on-prem email server, and if the email server is down, that means nobody can get that application. Nobody can get the email, right? So if you move on to a cloud, then it is better way that you don't have to manage that. So your business is not interrupted. So in that case, you will make a choice that okay, whether you want to completely move from that vendor to a new vendor, or whether you can actually substitute that with another application which is already there.
So, Sharji, I think some of these aspects you have covered. Anything that you would like to highlight in terms of how the decisions are being made?
I covered most of this decision matrix. So basically, to reiterate, right, and the rehosting is basically a very fundamental part where you don't you don't do much things, right? Because you don't change your code, but it is basically you are hosting from one infrastructure to another infrastructure. And the same way, the refactoring, re-architecting and rebuilding and replace we talked about. So I have a question from your experience, Balaji. So if we think that, okay, now application need to be re-architect or rebuild, what is the fundamental thing that you would start with? And where, so in your experience, right, we have been partner in crime, yeah. Right? And we talked about all these things in our earlier implementation, right? Just wanted from your insight that where do you start this?
Yeah, thanks, Sharji. Yes, so as we you would have realized, right, it's rebuilding and re-architecting means start thinking differently, starting from the way that we operate, right? So one of the key things that we would like to introduce, Sharji, you know about it, but that's what we did, right? The domain-driven design constructs. What is domain? Let me introduce few fundamental concepts, what it is, right? What is a domain? The domain is basically a functional domain, and wherein the business language is ubiquitously understood between all the stakeholders, right? Across all the stakeholders, be it the business, be it the business or product owners or the service owners. Product owners is basically the functional analyst. The service owner is primarily the technical lead or the developers, right? Everyone understands the business language ubiquitously. The second is the concept of domain-driven design is you don't need extra documentation. The code is design, design is code. So once you go through the code, you should be able to translate what that design means, right? So these are the two fundamental principles of a domain-driven design. And if you break it down to two major areas, the problem space and the solution space, right? The problem space, it is called a functional domain. Functional domain is primarily a bounded context, an area where the business language is understood ubiquitously. But when you start translating into a solution space, in a technological terms, it evolves something like a bounded context. A bounded context is basically a context in which all terminologies are same. So if we say, for example, if I take billing document, billing domain, it is a billing document, but when it goes to an invoicing domain, it becomes an invoice that is sent to the customer. It has a different perspective altogether, right? So when the business will start talking in a different language. Now, the objective of this domain-driven design is the interactions between one bounded context to another bounded context is through well-defined contracts and APIs. That's where you evolve the mindset of dictating a contract-based interactions. And what we call around those bounded contexts is something like an anti-corruption layer. You build some sort of an anti-corruption layer, and these anti-corruption layer talk to every other anti-corruption layer through a well-defined contracts and APIs, right? So it's not necessarily restricted only to cloud native. This principle applies to every design aspects of it, even within an ERP. And you know how we have done, right? Like is subscription and billing is a pod or what we call a bounded context, and finance is a bounded context and payment is a bounded context. And even within ERP, they talk to each other through well-defined contracts. So the way we start breaking this monolith into microservices is carve out those bounded contexts. Start with the domain concept in the problem space, then carve out the bounded context, and then start building module by module. So if you see here, this is a big ball of mud that Charji was talking about. You invariably keep adding the capabilities, and then one fine day you realize it is too big that I cannot control it. Then I want to break it into the various one of the 5 R's, right? Most probably we are talking about the rebuild and re-architecture here. Then so you start carving out the bounded context and then into certain modules. The modules can have their own maturity level to get to the cloud native. And then if you see, these can evolve from a monolith to coarse grain services to a microservices, right? It is a maturity level that over a period of time, in some situations, you may or may not be able to break that coarse grain into the deep microservices or fine grain microservices, primarily because it could be a shared database that we are dealing with because it's an ERP construct. But the fundamental philosophy is, if you look at it, the traditional way of looking at it in the layered architecture, right? The high availability was the responsibility of the infrastructure layer. But as we move into the continuum towards the microservices and cloud native world, the philosophy is infrastructure can support application availability, but application should be equally able to deal with infrastructure non-availability. That means failing over at the right time. And you talked about the continuous availability, right? Those aspects start maturing when it comes to a cloud native. So that's how the whole cloud native world evolves. So it's not like jumping from monolith to microservices. There is a continuum, and you start breaking the monolith into modules, into bounded context. And the way that you deal with bounded context can vary on a case to case basis. That's our experience, right, Charji?
Yeah. So Balaji, I think you've touched upon 2 points, right? Microservice and API. So many of the developer folks, if you talk to, right? So they would say that a microservice is not API or API is not microservice. So microservice basically is, it does a very small part within that domain. And in API has a business purpose, right? It has its own life cycle. So that is the Balaji talked about an anti-corruption layer, right? So that API is the one which you are going to talk to the other applications or to any external, right? So for example, when you are interfacing with a user, you have a user interface, that API is the one which is going to talk about that. It is not the microservice. So underlying the API would orchestrate those microservices. So microservice remains within the domain, and API, there are two services. One is an application service, which is basically the API part, and the domain service, which is basically the microservice part.
Thanks, Shaji. I think that helps, right? If you then try to summarize, right, how you go into this journey. So basically, the fundamental is when you started, you had a layered architecture, right? That is traditional way of looking at. There is an UI layer, there's an application layer, there's a persistent layer, and so on, right? And typically, when you do a project, we need to bring all these people, including the middleware team, to get the project done. There was a Conway Marvick Conway, I think. As early as 1970s, he experimented. What he said is, it was during time of COBOL compilers. So he created two teams, okay, two set of teams primarily. One set of team had two independent sub-teams, and another three independent sub-teams, and asked them to create a COBOL compiler. You can imagine what they ended up with, right? The two-step compiler and the three-step compiler, right? So primarily, what his philosophy and still holds good is, the organizations design their solutions or architect the solutions depending on the communication patterns, right, between themselves. So in the layered architecture, we had multiple layers. Obviously, the team was split as a portal team and user experience team, and then there's a middleware team and the database team need to come together to start delivering the project, right? The one of the things that we started doing is breaking down, instead of delayed constructs, we started having a domain construct. So we started breaking the team into domains, a marketing domain, an order management domain, a payment domain, and so on. So which means over a period of time, obviously it's a very crude way we started saying that every developer need to know one stack up and one stack down. Over a period of time, the team was creative, adopted a single full stack delivery model using, in our case, is a Spring. Spring Boot, and took the complete control. It could be Python or whatever maybe, right? The full stack of end-to-end delivery, or instead of having multiple teams coming together, the same domain team started working together and coming with a full stack delivery to start working on their projects and initiatives, right? That's, and then started as we talked about breaking down the monolith into a set of bounded context, the bounded context within themselves having well-defined microservices, interacting across bounded context through well-defined APIs and contracts. So that became a way of life and experience. And then it started building, carving out module by module and start generating we are probably the maturity between the coarse-grained microservices to the fine-grained microservices on a case-to-case basis, depending on the context. That's where it's, I would say, our experience in terms of breaking a structured up monolith into a structured approach. So going back, a quick summary, I think 10 minutes before we are trying to close so that we'll leave time for Q&A. In quick summary is a cloud native infrastructure, the traditional way of infrastructure doesn't hold good when we want to modernize our applications. A cloud native apps mindset, but primarily we need to recognize that it may not be the solve for everything. There are 5 R's. There are multiple ways of cloud deployments that is available on the available, but start thinking in terms of domain-driven design to start breaking your monolith, and obviously DevOps culture that you build, you run. That's the foundation of everything. I think that's what we had for this now, and open for the questions. Vaibhav.
Great. So I think, thank you, Balaji and Shaji. We have some really, really great questions lined up, and I'll get right to them. The first question is, how to identify your apps that are the best candidates for cloud transformation?
I think, I can take that question. So I think we briefly touched upon this, right? So where identify those applications where you see that where you can actually give an impact to the customer or to the to your colleagues, right? Where then application which is an operations team who is managing those applications. Identify those applications where you can actually provide that value add. And that is one way, right? So if you look at from the current situation, right? So if there is an application that actually needs a thick client and you need to be there in office, in this situation, it becomes impossible for anybody to go to office and do the work, right? And if you think that, hey, I have such an application, and that is one of the applications that you need to think about and see that whether you can transform that into a cloud native application. And also look at from your data perspective, right? Identify such applications where the revenue impact or the operational efficiency can be brought in. And these are the areas that you can look at it. Balaji, you want to add anything on this?
Yeah. And I think that covers, Shaji. Primarily, what we need to look at is, again, value versus trade-off, okay? Risk also plays a role. When it comes to risk, probably depending on the risk appetite of the organization, right? If the organization is having a good risk appetite, you can go with high value and do a sort of a white cloud approach to that. But if the organization is not having that risk appetite, start small with the low-hanging fruits. Doesn't impact the business when if it comes down, because obviously the fail fast philosophy holds good here. And then because you want to build on the success of that, right? So over a period of time, build the success. It's all very contextual to the organization.
Great, wonderful. Okay, the next question is, what are some of the factors to consider to get the most value out of your app transformation?
Okay, I can start with that. So yeah, that's actually a good question, right? So if you look at from the application perspective, we talked about a cloud native application, right? How do you actually get the most of the value? So when you are building such application, you need to ensure that you are building an application which is a completely decoupled and abstract application, right? So when I say abstract means all the 12 factors of microservices, you can imagine that that would actually give you a complete decoupling from infrastructure. So tomorrow, if your application landscape changes, you can deploy this application in any circumstances. And then the second part is basically the portability I talked about, right? So you don't get into a vendor lock-in, and you can imagine that. So Balaji talked about an anti-corruption layer, right? If you have an application where you can build that capability and seamlessly move from one cloud to another cloud, the portability perspective. So that is another factor that you can look at. And then also look at from the standards perspective. Like there are three types of standards. One is an industry standard. So if you look at from industry standard perspective, that okay, how does your application talk to other applications? So either you through an REST API or SOAP API. So these are basically the industry standards. And then comes the de facto standards, and then the your corporate standard, right? You will not venture into a completely unknown using an unknown software and build an application, right? So for example, if you are using Java or Python framework, and you wanted to completely use a different Ruby on Rails or anything, something like that, this is going out of your corporate standards, right? And then it becomes difficult for you to venture into area, or maintainability perspective, you will have issues. So those are the factors that you need to consider to get the most value out of your application.
Yeah, but I will also anchor on fundamental is why are you doing this, right? If it is basically, it's three fundamental answers to it. I need to be taking the code faster to the market, okay? So which means it should be contained, and I should have confidence on the code quality. So which means that should be a good piece of the reason why I should be breaking it down or deal with it. The second one is primarily coming from the perspective that what it gives me, or rather what is the dependency it creates, right? It is independently operatable, deployable units, right? That's going from a perspective as what Shahji said, how do I able to deliver the piece end to end without dependencies, or able to abstract out the complexities from dependencies on other applications and so on, right? So basically what we are talking about, time to market, ability to decouple the dependencies so that again, agility is ensured. And the third one is in terms of what is the return on investment that I do. Return on investment is always in terms of value, that high value solutions that we need to take it to market.
Great, great. All right, so the next question is, what should successful enterprises do to accelerate their journey to the cloud? And I think there's an additional question to this. Some of the factors to consider in terms of maximizing security when doing so.
I'll try to take the first question. For whatever reasons, right? I strongly believe able to do a, means we should be able to do it only, it's sustainable when it comes to a bottom-up approach rather than a top-down drive by a purpose. Basically, so the team who is rallying behind need to know the purpose, why they are doing it. And second is do a bottom-up approach. Bottom-up approach can start with a minimum pilot, but institutionalize over a period of time, because people do understand the value of it, the flexibility it brings on the table, and then do, get mature over a period of time. Trying to do a top-down probably maybe may not be successful, but our experience has been starting with few pilots. But right now I can say 95% of all our custom applications are cloud native in some form, or rather between the cloud, ready to cloud native, majority in the cloud native world. And the second aspect is 95 to 97% of it goes through the DevOps CI/CD constructs for us. Including a single instance path, actually. So it's all started in 2015 with the bottom-up approach, and it's been quite sustainable. So that's second question on security, Shahji, or you want to add on first as well?
Yeah, I think Balaji, I think first one you have you have answered already. So employee, basically to start with, the, as we said, right, employee experience. How do you improve their experience? That can improve the productivity. We talked about the application that can, the approval application, right? Where everything comes onto your mobile app, and where you don't have to go to individual application to approve. So these are the area, or you can enable a chat bot about the employee expenses or leave or HR related questions. So these are some of the areas that you can start with, and then increase that the experience of your internal customer, and then take it to the next level, as Balaji mentioned. And coming to the second question, security, right? If the security, so there were a lot of concerns regarding the security in cloud, but now the cloud has already matured, right? Now, if you have to develop a payment gateway, you will not develop that payment gateway, because there are a lot of security challenges and standards and the compliance required, right? You would obviously go for a cloud provider who can provide a payment gateway. Or if your application is basically need to be built, which is a health application, right? You need to be compliant with the HIPAA standard. So in such cases, the security is mostly highly regarded as a first class citizen in cloud. So because all these cloud vendors, Google, Azure, and Amazon, they invest a huge amount of money in making their services more secured. I think the security is a concern. The best way is to, if you do not have a security architecture within your enterprise, the best way is going to the cloud.
Great. Okay, so this next question, we've been asked this question by multiple folks who have joined us today. How do you ensure speed and consistency of application modernization across multiple portfolios and technologies?
Yeah, I'll try to answer this question, right? Typically, when Gartner did introduce this FIA, they also came up with the concept of bimodal IT. Luckily, we didn't fall into the trap of that bimodal IT, right? The concept of bimodal IT is basically all your customer facing applications or anything can be faster, but your finance can be slow, right? There are two models of dealing with application ecosystem, but we said, no, that's not true. Because in our world, the customer interactions and whatever is in the back office, whatever we call, is a continuum of the customer interactions, and it has to mature at the same speed. But obviously, what we said is everything is different. We'll have a same set of metrics that everyone is working towards. We have the three macro metrics that like feature velocity, cost of feature, and the cost of quality, right? So these are the three macro metrics that everyone will be working towards, but their maturity level could be different, like your fingers in your hand, right? It could be at a different maturity levels. Obviously, the reason why this is shorter to this one is different because that's how I can hold something up, right? So there is a reason. So maturity levels could be okay, but everyone works towards the same goal. So that's how it alignment happens. We didn't luckily fall into that bimodal IT concept, and I think that's how it helps.
Yeah, to add to that, right, Balaji talked about this Marvin Convoy's law, right? If you start building a system which is based on your organization, then it becomes challenging part to maintain the consistency, right? So that is where you need to have a governance model, and you need to have a cloud operating model, right? Where you need to identify that, okay, which application that can be considered, right? When you take that portfolio, the technology portfolio that you want to move on to the cloud, identify the team and make one single team, because even though it is hard to decompose your organization structure, but you can bring those people and create that one team, and then build that and hand it over to the cloud operations team. And that way you maintain that consistency, and over a period of time, when it matures, you can have a governance model on the cloud. So that ensures the speed and consistency of the cloud adoption.
Great. Okay, so I think we have time for one more question. While people are modernizing apps, you know, they're using microservices as a strategy to break down the monolith. How are API and microservices complementary?
Sure, yeah. I can take that question. So we talked about, Balaji was talking about the domain model where we talked about microservices and API, right? So many people both are same, but they are fundamentally the same, but the constructs are different, right? Because API has basically a very strong construct, because that is where you are interacting with, you know, either within internally within the applications, other application, and you expose that to your customers or your partners, right? Because that is one of the armors in your cannon going to be, because if you are providing that kind of an application area, and even if you have your front end application is not available, your customers can still interact with you through that API. So that is where you need to have an API strategy as part of your modernization, and where you maintain that API cycle and having that the documentation and the API catalog. And there are so many companies, like if you go to Twitter developer site, right, you'll see all the Twitter APIs. And there are companies like Twilio and SendGrid. They have productized. So you have to have that API as the product thinking brought into that. So API plays an important role in your modernization.
All right, great. So guys, it's almost 5:05. So guys, do you have any closing comments that you'd like to share with the audience before we bring an end to this session?
Thanks, Vaibhav. I think for this session, and I think it was a great experience. Some of these questions were nice. I'm seeing a few more questions which you are not able to answer, but nice questions. We'll try to answer it offline as well.
Yeah, same here, Vibor.
Great, wonderful. All right, so guys, with that, we bring an end to an hour of wonderful insights, right? I think it's been a great learning session for all of us. And I hope you guys also had fun, Shaji and Balaji. Thank you so much. And you know, I'd like to thank VMware for collaborating with us. And to all the attendees for joining us and staying with us through this 1 hour. Also guys, there's a small survey towards the end of this webinar. If you guys would like to give us your feedback, that will help us make necessary improvements in the future. We hope you, your families and friends are all safe. You continue to take all the necessary precautions at the pandemic times. Have a great weekend, guys. Thank you so much. Also, I'll share my email ID in the chat box, guys. Any questions that you have, you know, please forward it to me. I'll forward it to Balaji and Shaji, and we'll make sure that we also take those up offline. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks. Appreciate you taking your time.
Thanks, Vibor.
On a Friday. Thank you.